People have been drinking coffee for over 1,000 years, and tea drinking goes back even further than that, with an almost mythological history stretching back nearly 5,000 years. But caffeine has a secret hidden history far beyond its relevance to human culture. It's had multiple evolutionary origins, spread over 100 million years of diverging evolution, and all arriving at the same outcome. But first, caffeine is a stimulant to humans. Billions of us use it every day to wake up in the morning, power through work and assignments, or just because we like the taste. How many cups have you had today? The cultural impact of this small molecule can't really be ignored. It's the most commonly consumed drug on planet Earth, with an estimated 70,000 cups of tea drunk every second. It really can't be avoided in day-to-day life. Caffeine has two major sources for human consumption, the tea and coffee plants. These are hugely important economic crops, with markets worth $17 billion a year for tea and $102 billion a year for coffee. Both the tea and coffee plants belong to the same massive group within the flowering plants, called the asterids. Asterids comprise around 80,000 species across 100 families, including things like the nightshades, like potatoes and tomatoes, as well as the tea and coffee families, Taceae and Rubiaceae. Just by the way, plant taxonomic names are really difficult to pronounce, so apologies in advance if I get them wrong quite a lot. While they are in this same massive group, the tea and coffee families are actually not that closely related to each other. The coffee family, Rubiaceae, seems to belong to this subgroup of asterids called Gentianales up here, while tea fits in with a subgroup called Ericales down here. Here's a similar representation, but trimmed down to make it easier to see. Ignore the cocoa plant for now, that's a bit of a spoiler for later on. But here's the thing, the expectation in evolutionary science is that two species or families with similar traits, like caffeine production, should tend to be closely related to each other, with a single common ancestor that they both inherited that shared trait from. This would be the simplest explanation for why they both share that single complex trait. It's more likely that evolution would produce a complex trait once and then propagate that into new descending lineages than it would be to produce the same complex trait twice independently. But actually, that's often not the case. Occam's razor might say that the simplest explanation is the most likely one, but the most likely explanation isn't always the correct one. There are countless cases of convergent evolution, where distantly related groups evolved to have either very similar or even the same trait. This is what seems to have happened here with caffeine. The caffeine molecule produced by the tea and coffee plants is identical, but the two families are not close relatives within the asterid group of plants. And in fact, only a handful of species in each family can make the caffeine molecule. Coffea arabica and Canephora, and a handful of other Coffea species, are the only ones out of the whole Rubiaceae family, containing somewhere between 11 and 15,000 species, to produce caffeine. Meanwhile, Camellia sinensis, the species from which all commercially grown caffeinated teas are cultivated, is the only one out of the roughly 600 species of the Taceae family to do so. This means that caffeine production is an unusual thing, and that this one small molecule, identical in the species that make it, has had multiple independent origins. Not just twice, but in around 60 different plant species. Tea and coffee we've already mentioned, but some species of citrus, the chocolate plant, and guarana plants also produce caffeine, as well as the cola plant, yerba mate, and holly bushes, just to name a few more. These plants belong to a relatively small number of families that are not closely related to one another, Remember that we saw where the chocolate plant fits in relative to tea and coffee earlier on. Something really interesting about this case of convergent evolution is that each different convergence on the caffeine molecule found a different way to synthesize that same identical molecule, either by using different biochemical pathways or by using different enzymes to catalyze the steps in that pathway. As a side note, lots of the biosynthesis and physiology of caffeine in plants is not very well researched or characterized, with a strong preference for research on tea and coffee plants, probably for obvious reasons. So that's what we'll have to mostly focus on here. This figure shows all of the possible biochemical pathways to make caffeine from its alkaloid precursors, xanthine and xanthosine. The pathway highlighted in bold at the bottom here is the one used in tea and coffee plants, first converting the xanthosine precursor to methylxanthine, then to theobromine, and then finally to caffeine. While the pathway is the same in these two species, each uses different enzymes to perform it, encoded by related but different genes. Incidentally, the theobromine precursor of caffeine is one of the compounds that contributes to the flavor of chocolate. It's also what makes chocolate poisonous to dogs. It was discovered recently that other caffeine-producing plants, chocolate, guarana, and citrus, use different pathways to tea and coffee, and different genes encode the enzymes needed to perform them. They also start from a different alkaloid precursor, with the chocolate, citrus, and guarana plants starting the process of synthesizing caffeine with xanthine, rather than xanthosine like tea and coffee do. Citrus even seems to have two possible routes through the pathways shown in this diagram, able to modify xanthine in two different ways to start the process, before making theophylline and using that as the final precursor for caffeine, rather than using theobromine like the other caffeine-producing plants do. This case of convergence seems to have happened through multiple independent cases of gene duplication, where sections of DNA accidentally get copied twice during replication, resulting in multiple copies of the same gene. This was followed by the subsequent alteration and recruitment of those duplicated ancestral genes into the caffeine production pathway. For this family of genes that are involved here to be shared in both tea and coffee, that means they must have been maintained in the genomes of those plants for between 100 and 120 million years since their last common ancestor in the Cretaceous period, then independently turned to caffeine production. That would make the genetic architecture necessary for making caffeine as old, or maybe even older, than Spinosaurus. So it isn't that the process for making this useful compound has been preserved by evolution in all the different lineages that produce it. It's had multiple different origins, each using different biochemical processes and encoded by different versions of the same set of ancestral genes, in each case separated by many tens of millions of years of evolution and mutation. And they all arrived at this same outcome. But doesn't that seem wildly unlikely? So how has this happened? Well, like most things produced by natural selection, caffeine is very useful to the plants that produce it. Caffeine is a potent natural insecticide. While it's a stimulant to us, it's a neurotoxin to insects, causing intoxication and paralysis. Incidentally, so is the nicotine in tobacco. Nicotine is one of the most potent insecticides to occur naturally. If the plant accumulates caffeine to high enough concentrations in the parts that are being eaten by insect herbivores, it acts as a kind of chemical defense mechanism, protecting the plant against being eaten. This is sort of like the chemical equivalent of the spines of a cactus. But it's not just effective against insects. Caffeine released into the soil can prevent or delay the germination of other plants' seeds, giving an advantage to the seeds and seedlings of the caffeine-producing plant. And another somewhat confusing thing, caffeine is found in the nectar of some flowers, like coffee and citrus, where it seems to be linked to enhanced pollinator memory. If the pollinators have a better memory of the scent of a flower, they're more likely to return to that plant, giving it a better chance of becoming pollinated and therefore reproducing. This seems to run completely counterintuitive to the fact that caffeine acts as a neurotoxic defense mechanism against some insects, as it also acts as a memory enhancer to others, similar to its effects on us. What seems to happen is that the amount of caffeine present in the nectar is high enough to have the stimulant effect and attract the pollinators, but not be so high as to put them off with a bitter taste or to give them a lethally high dose. This may well be evidence of bees and other pollinators imposing a selective pressure on the citrus and coffee plants, preventing them from accumulating too much caffeine in their nectar, as that would then prevent them from becoming pollinated and being able to reproduce. Essentially, the caffeine molecule performs several functions that enhance the ability of the plant to perform in the field of natural selection, surviving external threats like insect herbivores and outcompeting its fellow plants. This provides the evolutionary incentive for multiple species across different families to evolve to produce it convergently. Convergence is a fascinating feature of evolution and occurs all over the tree of life. We've also touched on another deeply interesting and economically and socially important field of the biological sciences, the metabolism of plants. Plants produce a vast array of biochemically and physiologically active compounds. In fact, almost every drug used by human beings, either medicinally or otherwise, originally comes from a plant, like aspirin from the bark of willow trees, or the anti-malaria drug quinine from the bark of the cinchona tree. I hope you've enjoyed today's video. I did promise in my earlier porcupine video that I would do more on convergent evolution, and I plan on doing more again after this one. If you have any questions, please let me know down in the comments, and even if not, maybe just let the algorithm know how many cups of tea or coffee you've had today to help me out with the engagement metrics. Thank you for your time.